All right, welcome back to another episode of On the Margin, Roundup Edition. We've pulled Mike back from Europe, back from Brussels, back from ECC. We've got Quinn with the Patriot hat, and Tyler, what's going on?
What's happening? Mike looks very European today. Look at him.
It's the long hair.
Abstract.
I got a little like a little rat tail going in the back here, a little mullet type thing. It's just horrible. Yeah.
Party in the back. I kind of got the same situation going on too.
Yeah.
But you're Canadian. It works.
It's true.
Yeah.
I'm just jealous of your guys' hair.
What's your hair situation like these days, Tyler?
I got the 40-year-old Power Alley receding hairlines coming in here. You guys will have
to see. Still can dunk though.
Yeah, I can still dunk. Yeah.
So, Mike, you're in Europe. You went to ECC. Would love to just hear a bit, like, you know, for a crowd that's somewhat crypto curious and probably aren't really regularly going to conferences. Like, what was the vibe there? Where's sentiment at? What's the narrative? You know, it kind of feels like a lot of people are a bit lost right now, even though price keeps slowly grinding up. What's going on? What are you seeing?
Yeah. So for folks who haven't been or aren't familiar with the conference, ECC is the like an Ethereum ecosystem conference, and it's very developer centric. So it's much more for, it's not a lot of people there who are just kind of like retail or have a passing interest in crypto. It's mostly people that are full-time working in crypto and specifically within Ethereum, but also more on the technical side. So you don't get a lot of like Michael Saylor, even investor sort of high level talks. It's usually people that are really deeply in the weeds building. Sometimes last year when I went to ECC, I thought it was one of the best conferences I've ever been to. It was also in Paris last year, which I'm not gonna lie, makes a big difference. But there was a lot of energy and excitement around some of the new some of the things that were being tried. It was like account abstraction, people really excited about ZK. There's a lot of hype around MEV as a sector and some of the solutions that were starting to get rolled out there. And this year, I thought the organizers did a good job. I think people were being a little bit unfair about Brussels, but it sort of felt like everyone is 1 year further along in their roadmap. Instead of coming to solutions, they've actually figured out many more problems that they didn't see a year ago, and there's no new users to show for it. So the overall conference vibes, I think, was a little bit not great. But I will say that having hosted and attended many crypto conferences over the years, crypto conference sentiment is a very high signal contraindicator. So if you're at a crypto conference and everyone's hugging themselves and saying we're going to Valhalla and very excited and euphoric, that's not a great time to be owning crypto. And when people are kind of bummed and feel like the sentiment isn't so great, that's usually a pretty good time to be looking closer. So overall, I would say that the conference was it's always a good conference. It's always fun to like reconnect and see people, but it was also very dispersed this year. There are a lot of side events, so it's tough to even get like a cohesive sort of narrative of what people are excited about or working on. That was my takeaway.
That's pretty incredible, you know, considering the performance of crypto in general has been pretty good this year. I mean, that the sentiment's that bad and the attendance was down.
You know what I think it is? It's the lifeblood of crypto is new people coming in. And that's been the difference in this cycle versus previous cycle. Even though there's been a bunch of price appreciation outside of maybe some pockets like Solana meme coins and stuff like that, there just aren't that many new faces or people coming in. And that's helpful because it's validation for the space. It usually coincides with price going up, but it's also fresh blood, new ideas, new projects. It starts to feel very insular if you don't have that infusion of new human capital. And I think that's what people are feeling. At the moment.
It feels like at the same time too, a lot of the, you know, veteran characters, like people like Kobe or whatever, are getting pretty tired of the whole game. Like it feels like a lot of those longtime veterans that people look up to are also, you know, they're just not paying as much attention now. Like they've made it, they've been through a lot of these cycles now. And so at the same time that you're not having these new people come in, the veterans are just kind of getting tired and jaded. And I don't know, it feels to me like a lot of like these crypto native signals are really starting to get disconnected from actual price action. And you know, just look at like the last couple of weeks, like I know I've been like pounding the table that like the macro is just like super, super bullish and going into a really interesting moment. And at the same time, a lot of like crypto Twitter, like main characters are like either selling the low or sidelined or shorting at the same time. And it just feels like at that same time, ETF flows just keep slowly, you know, grinding higher. Like, you know, there's a lot of worry about ETF flows being purely momentum. But when I just look quickly at like total cumulative flow to the chart of Bitcoin, like this is just, you know, just keeps slowly grinding up higher, even though like price isn't hitting new highs. So I think this idea that, you know, the crypto veterans are the strong holders while the momentum chasers are buying the ETF and going to panic and sell. I think it's sort of feeling like the opposite is happening right now. What do you guys think?
Well, look at this. I'm just typing in the year-to-date returns. ETH up 64% year-to-date. Bitcoin up 40% year-to-date. The QQQ is up 16.5% year-to-date. You'd think that sentiment would be the complete opposite and people wouldn't be, you know, pushing like simple. Well, actually, let's check out Nvidia just to make sure. Okay, so Nvidia is up 141%. So, I mean, relative, that's been the best, but like, I mean, still 60 and 40% returns is pretty incredible and sentiment in the dumps.
I think it all boils down to the changing market structure. I mean, if you zoom out here and you say like, and you just kind of lay out the facts of what's happening is the industry is, the ETF is kind of the defining moment where this industry is moving from the leveraged kind of, you know, stay at home day traders to the institutions, right? And we've always been talking about that, but I would say, you know, the ECC comments is reflective of the altcoin market because that's what it is. It's the protocols and it's the yeah. VCs who, you know, are having a tough time because there's no liquidity events. And, you know, that's a byproduct of what's actually been built on the application side. But then you go to the Coinbase institutional or the BlackRock institutional events and, you know, these people couldn't be more excited. And so I think it's just all kind of like a good, you know, example of the changing tides in the industry. And it says something about, you know, how pretty much every bull case for crypto now lies more around the institutional adoption of the majors versus in 2021, it was, oh my God, like, you know, the crypto applications are going to change how we do all of these things. And people realize that there's actually not that much great stuff being built, but blockchains, tokenization, et cetera, you know, have really stolen the show from an institutional perspective. And, you know, I think everything's played out to that point and it continues to be the main theme in the market.
I mean, not even just institutional adoption, but also like political adoption. You know, we're starting to see some like pretty crazy headlines coming through of like, you know, there's rumors that, you know, Trump is going to be talking at the Bitcoin conference in a couple of weeks and he might be announcing there that one of his policies will be having Bitcoin as a reserve asset for the US. Like the amount of like the tail risk of like shorting when you have those sort of potential headlines coming across the tape is like pretty insane to me. And that just shows like, you know, people are just way too focused on the short-term structure. Meanwhile, you have these like, imagine hearing that idea even like a year ago. Like the tide is shifting substantially and people are just being super complacent about it, I think.
I'm so surprised. If I saw a headline like that, I would think Bitcoin would be limit up 15-20%. That the fact that that's even being rumored is just nuts. And the Chinese news of, you know, in Q4, apparently China's going to open Bitcoin back up. Those two in itself are pretty shocking headlines. So we'll see what picks up.
What do you think it is that, I mean, because the last, I mean, the, you know, I feel like we've been doing a pretty good job of calling out why the macro is bullish right now. And a big part of the reason why Bitcoin wasn't moving was just Germany was busy selling 50,000 of their Bitcoin in a not super intelligent way from an execution perspective. So there's also at the same time that you've got these bullish headlines, there's also Mt. Gox, Mt. Gox selling, which looks like it's actually finally going to materialize here. So maybe there's some weird sellers or something out there, but like, why do you guys think that Bitcoin hasn't been as responsive to all this stuff?
So maybe just stepping back a little. So I flip very bullish on or bullish from a neutral position on around June 20th. And looking back, that's also probably the right move from a macro perspective, which is the bulk of my process. You look at ARK and other liquidity momentum, things Bitcoin's correlated with, gold in the traditional world, and they all bottomed right around there. And obviously crypto took 2 to 3 weeks to kind of come out of the slump. you know, if you think about pure selling pressure, that was Germans, because I don't think there was a ton of the GOX distributions yet over those weeks. There was also Genesis involved. And what I think happened was, we've obviously over the last few months seen how poor sentiment has gotten altogether, and kind of jaded and bearish people have been due to most of their altcoins underperforming. And so that was, I kind of see it as more of like a capitulation moment. I mean, in the Germans' case too, right? Like, it's unlikely there was anything political, and they were just probably seeing Bitcoin price drop and panicking and dumping everything. And I liked Andy Constant's tweet. He goes, the German selling was only poor execution if price is higher in a week or two. And I think everybody, yeah, and here we are. And so that's the right take, right? Like, if price was at 40K, it would have been good selling. But when you peel everything back, I think the market was extrapolating the German case to what is going to happen with GOX, the Genesis, and all these other potential supply overhangs, as if they're going to execute in the same way, which we know GOX holders have been holding Bitcoin for 10 plus years. And there's just many different nuances to the cases. And so I think it's just kind of capitulation from that. And what's happened now is the Germans stopped, you know, the second their big orders stopped making the market go down, people saw the bottom forming and we sprung right back. And, you know, we're a little progressed in that positive macro tide. You know, there could be a little area here where the Trump bump kind of falls away if there's a new Biden replacement that has better odds. You know, there's been a bunch of things around the geopolitical front that have maybe fallen by the wayside. And you know, obviously Trump's recent comments on Taiwan and the semiconductors AI, which have been leading this rally. So I do think there's like the possibility for some weakness here. And it's unfortunate because crypto took so long to catch up. That would be a headwind. But yeah, at the end of the day, I think pointing to like the ETF, the ETH ETF as being this, as going to play out exactly the same way as the Bitcoin ETF is probably wrong. And people are bearish as it not having any interest, when every fact pattern into the run-up has been different. It still might be the sell the news if we get like a 10% pump before Tuesday, right? But the fact pattern's different. We were at local highs for Bitcoin at the time of launch. People wanted to lock in profits, rotate, et cetera. And things are just different here. And I don't think people are looking to dump their coins at the range lows as long as the macro is supportive. So to me, it's just like the psychology of markets where people get overly negative sentiment at the bottoms and kind of miss the forest for the trees of all the bigger picture turning points that, you know, liquidity is just the baseline is much better in Q3 than Q2. Just different dynamics playing under the surface. So that's kind of, I think, one you can rest your laurels on.
You know what gets me is like market structure. This game is so much harder because the market structure and the players in the game have changed. And one of my favorite quotes was from John Burbank. He said, last price is a liar. Price is really an equilibrium of liquidity. And what that really means is like low volume trading isn't exactly where the real market is. It's just, you know, and then you have these events where you see a lot of volume trades at a certain price and you get a real clearing price for an asset or an asset class. And I think that's kind of what we're seeing, you know, in low volume trading. When Germany decides to sell 50,000 Bitcoin, then you get really low prices. But then obviously when liquidity actually comes in, you find like a baseline of where real buyers and sellers are at. You know, that's actually the equilibrium of liquidity of where the market really is. But I agree with you on the big, you know, I got some great charts on the liquidity cycle, especially in fixed income later in the show. That'll show you, you know, what I think is we're actually starting a whole new capital cycle here.
Yeah. I think before we get into that, we could shift gears a bit to what we're seeing in terms of Fed rate cut expectations over the next little bit. Quinn, you shared this chart in the chat that was really great, just looking at Fed funds expectations. And, you know, this is something that, like, again, I talked to Andy Constant this week, and he's been pretty correct on this idea of just like these financial condition loops that just keep occurring. And as we get to this like max priced in moment of Fed cuts is when we see like this reacceleration in the economy again. So, you know, I've been talking a lot about this economic slowdown that's been happening, and you know, we were pretty early to that, and it feels like that's largely consensus now. But we're also getting to that point now where I don't know if like it feels like we're getting to the point where there's almost like too many cuts priced in once again, and we're sort of seeing that chart now. So just to set the stage, like September, we're now at 100% odds of a September cut. I think that's largely baked in. We have the July meeting coming up in 10 days or so, where I imagine Powell will set the stage for that. In between those two meetings, there's also the Jackson Hole Symposium, where that's often a time where we see the Fed announce these big regime shifts in their monetary policy. So it's quite interesting to see how this has become fully consensus. And I'm trying to decide whether I think that we see this reacceleration again. You know, just looking at like the Atlanta Fed GDP came in a couple of days ago, and just as everybody was starting to call for a recession is when we started to see this bounce up again. We had a pretty strong retail sales print come out a few days ago as well. So I'm trying to figure out whether we're going to go through one of these financial condition loops again, and whether we see like the long end start to sell off once again. Do you guys feel like we see the slowdown continue, or do you think we see this rebound coming?
I'm in the rebound camp. I think the economy is still strong, and the at a minimum, I think the rebound might not be in, it might be similar to 2022, where the rebound's in Main Street, not Wall Street, and you have back to this two-speed economy environment. Because I just have a very difficult time in getting like super recessionista on the economy when the government's spending the 6% annual budget deficits. So that's like my default bias. I would say when I look at that rate cut chart, given my bias about the economy being more resilient, is that is too much, too richly priced for rate cuts at 5 in the next 12 months. My base case is probably more like 3. But it doesn't necessarily mean that if this chart goes from 5 back up to 3, that it's bad for markets, because I think this scenario where this number would be kind of scaled back would be economic data starts to improve. I think if the economic data continues to worsen, the Fed has kind of, you know, displayed their adherence to growth over fighting inflation. So this might be real if the recession, you know, vibes continue. So I think the market's kind of fair across the board. It's hard to find like anything that's super undervalued after this huge rotation in small caps.
I'm actually more worried that the Fed's behind the eight ball on easing, and not for all the other reasons people think, but if you look at break-even inflations that we look at almost every week here, the one-year break-even keeps seeping lower. It's at 0.91, and the two-year break-even is now at 1.88%. So forward-looking inflation, market-based inflation, is actually dropping like precipitously now. I mean, what's that telling you? What? No one, that's not the market narrative that people are really looking at. And I'm kind of wondering why. Is it China slowing? Is it the US slowing? Like, is growth about to hit like the retro rockets here? And are we going to see like massive misses from big tech? I don't think it's draconian. Like, if you look at credit spreads, they're actually pretty tight. I think this is a like Quinn said, a handoff from high growing tech things like large cap tech to smaller cap things. And which is why mm-hmm. we saw this massive blow up in the dispersion trade. And yeah. I think that probably keeps going for the next year as rate expectations or rate easing expectations go lower, as we get this monster rotation. I think we've actually been pretty good and better than most on that.
Yeah. Did you guys see this chart of IWM call volume? The degens are piling in their calls. Like, you know, gone is the day of zero DDEs on NVIDIA. Now we're just, you know, degen trading IWM. And, you know, that's a pretty telltale sign of what's going on.
Yeah. I think, like, you know, when I see this, I'll fade it in the short term.
Yeah.
But I do think it was a 12% outperformance, I think, IWM to QQQ in under like 3 or 4 days, which is, you know, part of that implied correlation blowing up. It led to this, and you know, a lot of the hedge fund shorts were squeezed on this, and I think that's why you saw the call volume, you know, explode. But longer term, like if you look at like bank stocks, they're coming out of like a 2-year bear market here, which is kind of interesting, and there's been no real credit blowups that I can see.
The other thing as well that the Fed is going to pay attention to is the unemployment. And that feels like it's trending. Like a lot, I kind of agree with what both Tyler and Quinn said, that I think it's really hard to imagine. It's hard to get really in the recession camp when the government is running the deficits that it's running. And if you look at the last couple of reports coming out of the BLS, you can see all the jobs that are being created are in like government, either directly like government related jobs or like government adjacent type sectors. So it feels like that's what's kind of keeping everything in line. But I think there's actually like a lot of evidence that the employment situation is not looking as good in the real or the private economy. And the Fed pays a lot of attention to that. And that's the type of thing that once it starts to accelerate, it's like the most lagging indicator. So I don't know. I'm kind of in, I think everything feels pretty fair right now, but I agree with Tyler. Like, I don't think it's crazy. You know, there are a lot of people that are saying, hey, there should actually be rate hikes here. And I think that's crazy. I think that some amount of normalization is pretty called for at this point.
The only reason they're saying that was because the Qs were at all-time highs. They're not paying attention to like other stuff. I will say this, like there is inflation that I feel in certain parts of my like day-to-day life that clearly is detached from CPI. So I kind of get that, but making the cost of capital tighter on your like smaller cap stocks doesn't make sense anymore right here. And I think that chart that you just pulled up before, Felix, was so good on this.
Yeah. Yeah. I wanted to show this, and I actually wrote about this in the On the Margin newsletter yesterday, but it just really shows, I think, that it wasn't just technical implied correlation blow up trade stuff that led to the small cap rotation. It's actually quite fundamental too. So this chart's really great, just looking at just the debt structure of basically like small cap, like Russell 2000 stocks versus the S&P 500. And like 30% of the debt of like a Russell 2000 company is floating rate. And so floating rate is priced basically off like a market reference rate, normally SOFR, plus some sort of like add-on rate for the credit risk. So it makes sense that if their floating rate debt is 30% versus S&P is at 6%, you know, these flows have actually made fundamental sense. It makes sense to hide in the S&P 500 stocks over the last couple of years when rate hikes have gone up, but they've been able to term out their debt into fixed rate debt, way lower rates than where we've been at. But now that we're starting to see this reversal into lower rates, the floating rate debt's going to do better. So it makes sense to see this rotation too. I don't think it's just been like this purely technical thing. And, you know, I see a lot of people talk about how, yeah, it's like, oh, this is just technical and it's just like a short squeeze. But I do think there's like a fundamental reason as well.
Yeah, I agree with that. Like, you don't want to be buying after these crazy like Sigma moves we've had, but at the same time, you can't ignore the realities of why it's happening. And a lot of it, I think, has to do with like the speeches this week and the change in policy. I whether it's Republican or Democrat, I think people are seeing and understanding this. You know, you can't just keep choking off Main Street's access to capital. We talked about that before, where cost of capital is very cheap for Mag 7 and very expensive for regional banks and small, medium-sized businesses. And eventually, that's the lifeblood of the economy. It catches up. And, you know, whether it doesn't matter to Democrat or Republican, I think there's going to be policies enacted in the next year to 2 years that will help push that capital back to labor.
You guys, this was well worth watching this week, was the Mark Andreessen, Ben Horowitz.
I've heard that this is great. I haven't.
I mean, they have the charisma of a wet noodle, but I mean,
or an egg.
Yeah. It's like, you know, this is the way he like talks. It's just like a computer. Anyway, but what they say is just like, it's really incredible. It's a tectonic shift in policy. And what basically they said is you need to make little tech work if you want America to work. You can't just like kowtow to just giant large cap tech companies, which we've talked about here. It creates like this big tech dystopia. And so they met with all these legislators across both sides. And Horowitz, he's like from Berkeley, California, basically was communist. And he's like, this is an existential crisis. People do not understand how bad this is. It's not all Democrats. It's just the administration is basically like hijacked things. And essentially made it. So we're turning into this like big tech dystopia. And the only people that wouldn't meet with Ben Horowitz and Mark Andreessen, guess who it was? In Washington. Elizabeth Warren and Gary Gensler.
Nice.
And like they literally, it was an hour long of just jaw-dropping material of just like, wow, the pivot this guy made. Ben Horowitz is like, I'm going to have no friends. Like, you guys don't understand. I am like super liberal. I'm like the ultimate liberal pivoting to supporting Trump here. I mean, it's mind-boggling, the stuff that's happening. All because like it's an existential crisis. You need growth to be more distributed if you want America to work. So that's my rant for today.
You know why? That's why I find JD Vance's platform so interesting. Like JD Vance, he's the author, people know, of Hillbilly Elegy, which I think he wrote back in 2016. And the irony of that book is that it was kind of a liberal darling, right? It was the New York Times bestseller for a couple of months, and people used to love to look at that and say, hey, this is how this led to the rise of Trump, et cetera, et cetera. And he was a pretty vocal critic of Trump and is now obviously his running mate. But I think the interesting thing about his platform is that he's zeroed in on a problem which I think should have been getting much more oxygen in DC for a long period of time, which is the hollowing out of the middle class in the US. It's actually pretty amazing like that this is a country built on the middle class and we've hollowed it out and it hasn't been a political issue for like 40 years. How is that even possible? I don't even understand how that's possible. But
I mean, it's because they detract and, you know, they pit you against, like they try to detract from that core issue and be like, okay, it's this problem. It's, you know, this war over here and across the world. And I don't think people are aware of what the core issues are.
Yeah.
I think it's a media issue, honestly. I think, you know, these big coastal mainstream media companies that just pulled the lid over on America and just told them different stories of what was really going on. And now that you have decentralized media, all this stuff is coming true. And people are, you see it in the numbers, people are fleeing that stuff. And it's really fascinating. It's having the exact time that the politics are shifting. Is, I think this is a secular change. I think mainstream media, this was they're dead. I think they're dead and they know it. They have big balance sheets and maybe they can figure out ways to like buy podcast networks or Blockworks or who's going to sell out to it. I don't know. But I think this is the unbundling. We're watching Mike Ippolito's unbundling before.
Another interesting aspect with relates to financial markets with that point is how I'm just picturing when I first got into like finance and working in New York and stuff. If I told you that like the best equity research or macro report or whatever came from Twitter, you'd be laughed out of these institutions, you know, in New York. They'd be like, some loser on Twitter, you're getting your financial advice or your strategic, like you're taking insights from like Twitter. And that's Substack. That's another good one. Like I've had now like everybody I know in finance that's making investment decisions is following these channels, and they have their own Substack authors they like. We've seen all these famous bank economists and strategists go do their own Substacks. It's just all happening in front of your eyes and every part of that kind of, you know, information channels, let's say markets, media, et cetera.
Information's commoditized. And so you can aggregate really good data as like, say Lynn Alden's a great example of this. She has better stuff than like Goldman Sachs in a lot of senses. I shouldn't say like, you know, there's a lot of great things about Goldman too, but like the fact that she can do that as one person is really incredible.
Hello, hello, listeners of On the Margin. I've got good news for those of you who are in the crypto scene. Blockworks is bringing back Permissionless. We're going to be doing Permissionless 3, and this year we are heading west. So we're moving that out to Salt Lake City. That's going to be October 9th through 11th this year. We've got a phenomenal lineup of speakers for you. So we've got Balaji headlining. We've got Sriram Munib, Matt Hogan of Bitwise, Jan Van Eck. This one's going to be a blast, guys. And I saw many of you out in London for DAS this year, and I hope to see you out in Salt Lake for Permissionless. And because y'all are such faithful listeners, you've got, if you use code MARGIN10, you're going to get 10% off your tickets. Appreciate you all. Hope to see you out there.
And look, like this is why it's, you know, trying to navigate markets during like a freaking fourth turning situation like we're in right now is why it's so difficult. It's like this upcoming election, like depending on like if we get a sweep of Congress, you know, that could be the deciding factor between a recession or not, because we're in this world of fiscal dominance where a lot of, you know, the new jobs are in government, you know, government jobs and healthcare jobs, which is anchored to fiscal expenditures. So if you get a gridlock Congress, suddenly it's going to be a lot harder to pass bills. Suddenly the odds of a recession, I would say, would go up substantially. And I think that basically, you know, even though we're looking at try to forecast like Fed rate cuts in 2025, so much of that is anchored on how the election turns out and whether we get like a sweep from a party or not, because that'll just, you know, I would say that's one of the key deciding factors between whether we get a recession or not in the next year or so.
You think so? The who wins president?
Well, I would say like also like if you get like Democrats hold the House or something and, you know, Republicans hold the Senate and we get a gridlock, like it's gonna be a lot harder to pass fiscal bills, right? And that would slow down fiscal expenditures.
I might play contra to that, and can I give you a couple charts on why?
Sure.
All right, let's
we love your charts, Tyler.
Yeah.
All right, so I think the credit cycle is starting over, and this has more to do with monetary for the next 6 months. So go to slide 12. There's an interesting phenomenon going on in the credit markets. This is from the JP Morgan high yield guy, Nelson Jensen, which is really incredible stuff. But basically, this is the TINA. There's not enough investments in the bond market. The number of bonds are dropping. Number of issues in high yield bonds has decreased 78 or 8% since the beginning of 2022, the lowest amount since September of 2020. Notably, the number of issuers in the high yield market are declining for a third consecutive year as rising stars continue to outpace the fallen angels in net issuance. So this is the leverage loan credit spreads. And you'll see the red line is the spread to maturity. That just keeps coming down. Like you'd think if we were in a recession that the most sensitive part of the market would be widening. You'd see credit spreads widening. But because we're probably in a Fed easing cycle, you know, there's inflows into these funds. And go to the next slide. So this is high yield bond and leverage loan inflows for the week. We just saw $2.7 billion go into high yield bond funds this past week during this equity market turmoil, which is really fascinating. I could get into that too. But also leverage loans saw $1.1 billion in inflows. So you have forward inflation dropping and bond investors are saying, oh my God, real yield. And not only that, but you probably have like this demographic thing where pensions just need to keep allocating money to fixed income here. So I think that is what's really going to kick out this recession. Now, how bad is the big tech AI bubble? Do we see a massive drop off in earnings there? That's something, but I don't think that affects like industrials. I don't think that infects banks. That is just an earnings recession in large cap tech. So we'll see if that flows through. How much of that affects the rest of the economy is yet to be seen. But then here's this last good chart is chart 15 on the bond market. It says, notably, 2/3 of high yield funds experienced a quarter over quarter increase in cash balances with a median gain of 105 bips. We estimate average cash balances for high yield mutual funds increased 66 bips, representing the largest quarterly increase in cash balances since March of 2020 pandemic. High yield cash balances are now 23 bips above the long-term average. With new issuance tracking month-to-date lows, there's only $3 billion of issuance and inflows are reaccelerating to an 8-week high. So like you not only have you less supply of high yield bonds, but then you have inflows coming in. So it's just, I think that keeps the credit market salubrious. And in fact, if you have an easing cycle because inflation's dropping, then you're gonna have more bond inflows, which keeps cost of capital going lower, which keeps small caps working. And that therein lies, you know, we're seeing the shift, I think, from, you know, the large cap tech to more distributed, better growth for the rest of the economy and for Main Street, like, you know, Quinn was saying earlier. And a lot of the stuff hit a fever pitch. And that's why we're seeing Ben Horowitz and Mark Andreessen just yelling from the rafters, because we don't want big tech dystopia.
I think the other chart, I totally agree with this, Tyler. I see a non-zero percent chance that, I think the best analogy here is kind of the similar timeline of 2021, but I do see a non-zero chance that if inflation is not that big of a problem for the next number of months, if it remains muted, that it's more like Q4 2020 timeframe, where we're seeing this reinflection in economy. A lot of the manufacturing and industrial indices are showing forward looking reinflection higher for the economy. We're seeing it in Europe. Without a doubt, the European economy is strengthening. India and everything rest of world except China is quite strong and looks to be coming back. So I think there's a chance where if inflation stays all right, you get just this booming kind of middle class type of economy trade. And that's what we've seen in that rotation, right? A big thing that people have pointed to, and I think it's an important signal, is if you look at all the times of high rates in the last couple of years that have caused problems, right? That was October 2022, March 23, October 23. The second those rates dollar moves came off, you know, and we saw relief due to whatever sort of intervention, we saw home builders, new housing starts, all of this kind of housing data start bottoming and going back. That was missing this time around, right? So rates came down starting from kind of April, May, June, and pretty significant moves in the 10-year. But we didn't see, it felt like there was still kind of a you know, holding the beach ball underwater when it came to small caps and home builders. And with this last inflation print, that was kind of the nail in the coffin to get the Fed to pivot in like 3 weeks' time. They went from saying, you know, no cut, blah, 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 to like, oh yeah, it's definitely time. Of course it's time. You know, who would have thought it wasn't time to cut? And, you know, so we have this just drastic pivot in 3 weeks. And you saw that in stocks and home builders. And I'll take the stock market as a forward-looking indicator versus economic data. And that's telling me that you're going to see this reinflection higher. And maybe it doesn't come and people are off sides here. But I don't know. I'll lean on the side of what's happened the last three or four times around, and credit's widely available and it's good for the economy. It might not be good for your QQQs or your AI, which, and again, those have been, people need to understand that is not the market. That those assets became the safety trade because people wanted to denominate in dollars, but didn't want to put in treasuries because they're the worst performing asset for 4 years. So they went to AI, they went to NVIDIA, they went to these tech giants. And so as long as that doesn't completely bust and those just kind of chop, I think you continue to see this liftoff. If those break the whole market down, put a fork in it for the time being. But as long as those just chop and hold weight, it gives this room for everything else to breathe.
Drop the mic.
I mean, I'll say that's a super compelling argument against like this fiscal dominance thing that I just mentioned. Like, I could also see this dynamic where the baton gets passed from the public sector to the private sector. And yeah, maybe, you know, what you talked about last week, Quinn, about the crowding out effect, that if that slowed down, it allows these smaller companies to actually start to grow and flourish again. And I think that's also a really nice analysis, Tyler, about looking at high yield, because a lot of people, you know, look at like, okay, we have one rate cut in September, and there's this narrative these days that, you know, rate cuts don't mean as much, and, you know, what's 25 bips going to do to the economy? But I think this is like a very specific example of like, look, Fed funds rate, like SOFR is attached to Fed funds. Floating rate debt is priced off SOFR. When you lower that rate, it lowers the cost of capital for small caps. It lowers the credit risk for high yield debt. That allows people to pile in on high yield because they see the price upside. That lowers the potential for bankruptcy for these small caps. That allows them to be like take on more risk. That allows their company to do better. So I think this is like a clear mechanism that shows that, like, you know, Fed funds still matters in a way because floating rate debt is based off of it.
I think an important narrative is around the unemployment rate rise, right? So we had this debate, or people still debating it, whether it doesn't look like the typical unemployment rate rising cycles because of increasing supply. And I think that's been debunked a little bit in terms of where those jobs are coming from or going to, I guess. But I wouldn't be surprised if 2-3 months from now, the unemployment data starts to look better, or the jobless claims start to kind of fall back down to trend, and people all of a sudden say, oh, don't worry about it. You know, the unemployment rate, that's rising, but it's just because more labor supply is coming in, and it's rising for good reasons. So it's just funny to watch these pendulums, right? You kind of want to fade, you know, in June, it went all the way recession, oh my God, to watch it kind of come back and, you know, look to commodities and oil is my kind of signal for what we're going to be doing there.
What's fascinating is the divergence between equities and fixed income. Like, fixed income is pretty much looking great, in my opinion. Check out slide 8. I think this is all systematic nonsense that I keep talking about. So this is Scott Rubner's charts from this week, the Goldman guy. So these are vol control positioning. So basically he takes systematic investors and shows their positioning. They are fully invested, which I think when you have vol at real lows, everyone levers up. This is like the risk parity type trades. And what we're seeing is actually, and if you go to the next chart too, this is the US systematic positioning, max long. So this was basically at the end of last week. So this is CTAs, commodity trend advisors, risk parity, and vol controlled funds, all max invested in the equity market. And so now we're seeing what happens ahead of your earnings. You have a buyback blackout period, which opens up, you know, that takes out the low volume buyer, and you see the VIX pop. And you see finally the VIX goes from, you know, undervalued to 16.5 this morning. And in fact, the VIX might go inverted, which is one of the greatest, like, you know, contraindicators in the market. And implied correlation spiked. It was at 8. Now it's at 13.5. And this is all the stuff we've been watching the past couple of weeks. But here's the next chart is Scott Rubner's. August is the worst month of the year for equity flows. There are no predicted inflows in August as the capital has already been deployed for Q3. Buyers are out of ammo, and I'm on the lookout for alpha. So this, all this stuff is like, you know, price is a liar, price is equilibrium of liquidity. These stupid systematic funds, all of a sudden, VIX pops, then they buy more VIX and they buy protection, they deliver their equity books, even though the fixed income market is saying everything's fine. So this is just an equity vol systematic gut check right here from these stupid quant funds, because you've annihilated all these jobs. I mean, it's really, it's a lot of what you see. It's why J.D. Vance thing is, from macro pictures, is even more fascinating, is you annihilated Wall Street and now they're all robots and they do the same. There's no difference between stock A and stock C now, because it's all in these stupid baskets and they trade up and then they trade down together. And slowly over time, things kind of make sense based off earnings and whatever, but like intraday, all these stocks get roped in together. And then the last one, the next chart is just, this is the VIX versus the 3-month VIX. So front month VIX, and then the VIX index 3 months out. When you see a race to buy front month volatility protection, and that becomes almost more expensive than 3-month protection, that's been a historical great sign to buy the equity market. And I think it's all because these systematic funds do the same thing. They have the same MIT kids program, the same things. And now we're seeing, we're probably getting close to some sort of market, equity market bottom, unless there's a geopolitical event, fixed income, you know, short term. So I think that's sort of what's going on in the equity market, my 2 cents.
Big 10 kids would never.
MIT kids. This is what happens when you give MIT kids calculator and algorithm on steroids and they annihilate all these jobs as things become more destabilized.
The VIX term structure thing is super interesting. I have a question for you, Tyler. Maybe I don't know if you have the answer or not, but like I do look at this a decent amount of just the VIX curve, and like we see this weird dynamic where, so I think you're saying that there's like some backwardation in the midterm, is that what you're saying? But if you look at like, it looks like there's like this bump up front.
That's just election basically, related.
Yeah, election uncertainty. So my question for you is, Do you have an idea of like how that mechanism works, where as that like vol hedge rolls off, during the election in October, November. Do you have an idea of what that could do to the vol structure and therefore flows?
Yeah, I mean, like, this would be the Jim Carson, I think you sell. Yeah. You given to where the Trump is leading in the polls, I would be selling the hell out of October vol here.
Yeah.
It'd be basically like the event risk would go lower. It should be going lower already, given, you know.
Totally.
But hey, crazy things happen. So who knows? But generally, like, you'll see this in election cycle. Every election cycle, you'll see everyone buying, you know, October puts because they're all morons. Mm-hmm. Anyway.
And then as that rolls off, I could see that being like the gamma unpinning that just could lead to like a pretty big rally in the fall.
Yeah, because then you also have the Santa Claus rally and you have low volume buybacks into November, December. And, you know, if you have a salubrious outlook from the liquidity cycle, I mean, I say the word salubrious way too much, but
yeah, bro. No one's ever heard that refined, word,
dog. Tyler. Yeah.
I think I was an English major. Yeah. But I think that's why you're seeing Bitcoin might be actually sniffing out the beginning of the next liquidity cycle.
Little bit on the fixed income side, just while we're there, on Tyler, your point is, yeah. Notice the last 2 days, the most, let's say, vicious of the equity selling,
yeah,
has seen, been coincided with 10-year yields actually rising. So if that selling was extreme nervousness or pessimism or something about growth or the economy, you would see rates and yields, you know, going down as safety, right? But that's not happening. And that is, you know, you can't read anything in 2 days, but that's confirmation bias for my view that the economy is fine. But it is also a signal, right? Like, it tells you that this selling has been more driven by an actual rotation versus risk off. And what happened was we had I think Tony Greer said it something like it was like 4 or 6 standard deviation and the Russell above it's like 100 or 50 day moving average or something, which has never happened for any index ever. Like, just mm-hmm. how violent of a move it was. And we also saw like the two worst performance days for long short hedge funds in like many, many years. So these types of things where everyone was funding their longs with these shorts and that just got absolutely squeezed. What happens in those is they're capitulation moments, right? They're signals of the new trend probably, but in the short term, they're capitulation moments where everybody's just like, all right, our books are flying in the wrong directions. We need to degross. So everything gets slowed down, but then the dust settles, they degrossed, and you look around and you're like, wait, but this happened because people are more optimistic about the economy and growth and small, medium-sized businesses prospects. And you're like, well, we probably shouldn't be getting too bearish.
Wow. Special guest.
Let's go.
This is my 4-year-old Mac. Can you say hi?
Mac.
Yeah. Hey, Mac.
He just brought me a special treat.
Mac, do you think the Fed's going to cut rates in September?
Say yes. I heard he did.
Okay. Small interruption. He's wearing a Tom Brady jersey.
Nice. We love that. I got a question for you guys, high level. So the reason I think JD Vance's platform is so interesting is he's very focused on, Tyler, something that you've been talking about forever, of this capital to labor shift. And it seems like the most important thing for him is upward pressure on wages and reindustrializing the U.S. So when I think about what those policies require is, one, a weaker dollar, but then also it does feel a little like the rebalancing of that, right, of paying people more is maybe there's an inflationary impulse there as well. So I'm just curious, you know, like, let's just say in a hypothetical world, this is the economic platform and it's successful. How do you see markets reacting to that?
Over long term?
Long term, yeah.
I think IWM, smaller caps, this is a massive rotation to the middle class. And I think smaller cap stocks do better in industrial stocks, oil and gas, banks. I just think that's, and you probably have to deal with a little bit more inflation. You probably have more fiscal that goes to rebuilding some things. But I also think there's going to be a lot of deregulation. You know, there's going to be handcuffs taken off of industries that, you know, it's clear that's Musk's big push, and he's donating $46 million per month, I think it was. Yeah. And so they got to manage the inflation, but I think largely you might have a big productivity boom. Like, one of the greatest ironies is if you actually pay your employees more, there's a productivity boom. I mean, and everyone's like, all the economists are like, well, if you have wage inflation, then it's not good for the economy. And it's, there used to be this thing, what was good for General Motors is good for the US, or good for Ford, you know, Ford is good for the US. And that should be true again in that environment, hopefully. But yeah, you always have inflation boogeyman. But I think Trump's aware of it. He wants nuclear power. He wants oil and gas to pump. Yeah. He wants less, you know, there's a wartime, you know, Pippa Malmgren's been talking about this, but there's a peace dividend. If he gets a lot of the drama that's been going on in the world, messing up supply chains and shipping rates come down, there's a lot of disinflationary pressures that could come from that too. So, but on a larger, say 10-year basis, there's a reason the Teamsters president was speaking at the Republican National Convention. This is a rewriting of the social contract, in my opinion. Yeah. You know, people need to pay off their debts and we need to give them better wages. And I think that's really what we're going to see here over the next 10 years. And because it's gotten crazy. You know, one of the greatest questioning, you know, the guy at Boeing was getting questions like, how much money do you make a year? And he was like, $45 million. And he's like, or I think it was $30 million or something. And they said, how much was that over the last year? It said 45% increase. And you're like, so your company has done a shittier job and you're paying yourself up 45% while your employees are getting like 3%. Like, there's clearly something wrong with that just existentially. You know, granted, you know, if it's your company, you put the money up and your risk, and like, I get if you want to pay yourself a lot, like that's fine. But when it's that detached from like performance, that's crazy to me. You know, yeah. I think Musk should pay himself whatever he wants because like he's crushed it. You know, his stock goes up 10,000%. That's great. You have a shitty, if you do a shitty, you should pay yourself up 45%.
The Musk pay package thing is so zero. I would bet you anything that no CEO in the Fortune 500 would take that pay package. Absolutely none.
No, they'd zero, be like, there's no chance of hitting
zero base like, options based on ungameable metrics. No one
imagine hating that. The most successful, like the guy in our lifetime that's done the most for technological innovation in mankind, imagine hating that person.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I can't even see the logic behind
behind neither. One thing I'm trying to figure out based on like your original question there about policy on markets is, you know, a big policy of Trump is drill baby drill, and you know, getting a lot more supply of oil. So I'm trying to debate, does that lead to lower energy prices, but at the same time, a lot more supportive of, you know, regulatory red tape around energy companies. So do we see this dispersion between, you know, we see oil going down, but XLE going up, and like, I don't know, because you, go ahead, Quinn.
I have a broader contrarian take on this inflation thing.
I do too.
I mean, for me, it's just like, you know, this screwed people up last time, too. They're like, oh, Biden's going to get elected, you know, sell oil because he's super against oil. But it's actually, you should be buying oil because it's more restrictive. So is it the opposite now is my thing. But is that different for the corporate like earnings is basically my point. So I don't have an answer for that, really. But it's just something I'm thinking about.
So first, I played the opposite side that actually the president in the medium term doesn't really matter. It matters in the short-term narratives and the market trades off narratives and tactically in the short term. But over the next 1 to 4 years, I actually take the view that who's president doesn't really matter. And let me give a, considering I don't have any part affiliations, let me give you a contrarian take that goes contrary to what you hear about the inflationary potential of Trump. So the beauty of you know, estimating this impact is you can just look at 4 years that existed in our lifetime pretty recently of his actions that, you know, played out in markets, which we saw, you know, what is more inflationary, right? There, it's commonly pointed to as tariffs, his inflationary policies being tariffs and immigration, which those are true completely, right? Like tariffs are inflationary, which the counter to that is that Biden has not done anything to roll them back. In fact, has extended them. So you might get more tariffs under Trump. That's certainty. Immigration, it's going to be a stronger immigration policy. Immigration, you know, political, this is not like a political opinion, but it has been what's dampened inflation, right? Like it's what's helped weaken the unemployment rate because of supply. And it's also put a lid on wage growth because we've had such strong immigration and people willing to take more jobs. So that's true. But I would say the other things, your point, Felix, about oil, the relaxing of regulatory red tape and deregulation, I don't think can be understated. It's not going to show up in Trump, like if Trump wins, it's not going to be in the first 6 months. In fact, the supply constraints put on commodities and particularly the oil industry, production is rolling over for the first time in many, many, many years in the US. And that's because of a, you know, hostile stance towards it. So we actually probably continue to see strength in oil prices over the next year. But if Trump gets in, relaxing regulatory, you know, letting more land be used for drilling, that's good for oil prices coming down and inflation coming down. The other thing is, like him or not, there was way less U.S. involvement internationally in wars and spending. And so if you, you know, every time we write a check to Zelensky, that's a couple hundred billion dollars of our budget deficit, and that's inflationary as well. And I think, you know, these other things around that the Republicans wouldn't do around canceling debt and other things are also less inflationary. So I don't think the picture is that clear. In fact, I think being a believer in free markets, yeah, I tend to believe that actually less government intervention is ultimately better for capital allocation and therefore inflation pressures. And so I think, you know, viewing things just equally both sides, like I don't think it's that big of a shoe-in. And if you take these last market moves, remember these market moves started before the Trump assassination attempt, and they started on the inflation date because of monetary policy expectations, the lowering of that cost of capital for small caps. And then, yes, they got exacerbated after that, but that was kind of the blow off. All this pivoting under the surface and rotation of assets started because of that monetary policy move. And that's what's igniting things. And then you can assign other, you know, weak dollar, J.D. Vance trade policy type narratives to it. And of course that matters, but I would be cautious in kind of putting all the eggs in this basket, because again, I kind of boil down to this being more of a structural issue that the presidents themselves don't really change that much in the medium term.
This is my one other thought on the energy stuff is, and existentially, this is kind of a weird problem for markets, but energy companies historically, when energy prices are low, it's kind of like pro-cyclical, where when the energy prices are lower and you were levered, you were a real levered energy company, oil and gas, you pumped more because you had these debt payments to make, which caused an oversupply. Now, if you know that market's kind of balanced out, what happens if your cost of capital drops, your balance sheet's way better, and you end up buying back stock and you create like, you know, built, you know, I think that CNQ's buying back stock, like massive big oil companies are buying back stock now. What if they do the playbook that the big tech companies did on buybacks, where they issue debt, buy back stock as a giant oil company, and you don't produce more oil, you know, but you have this, like, you're still profitable and you're cash flowing. XLE could work along with oil as well in that environment, sort of what I'm saying. It's kind of a funky cocktail. But the oil market's obviously like it's commodity, it's globally traded. It's hard to like really have a year outlook on these types of things because it's so geopolitical.
I think it actually, there could be, like, this is one of those periods of time where there's change, and change can like go in multiple different directions. But here's what I would view as the best possible outcome for everything that's happening right now. I think that I view a lot of this stuff actually through this talk that you showed me years ago now, Tyler, the James Goldsmith talk about global trade policy and the impact of outsourcing. And, you know, a lot of economists will draw you that little productivity curve, and they'll kind of explain in a very condescending way that, you know, when you specialize trade, you know, excess benefits accrue. The question is, who do those benefits accrue to? And it wasn't to the majority of middle class people in the US. And I think that also explains why you actually had this period of unity, because the elites in both parties did extremely well in this ecosystem, in that like equilibrium. And that explains a lot of the tension even between guys like J.D. Vance and Mitt Romney, who I think are both really well-intentioned guys, but have just very different worldviews on this stuff. And I think you're going to rewind back a lot of what just transpired over the last 40 years or so. And I think that's probably a good thing, because that's the problem with, that's what's eating away at the heart of, I think, the middle class in the U.S. But at this, so I think that would be inflationary, but you also have these insane deflation. So deregulation, completely agree with Quinn, but also there's a bunch of other deflationary stuff. There's demographics, which is super deflationary. Honestly, the AI thing.
I think demographics are super inflationary.
Interesting.
Why? I've been starting to hear that idea.
Why do you think that?
So China's losing 8 million people per year in supply. So you essentially have to pay up for wages. I think it's the opposite.
Interesting. All right. So
I think it might be deflationary for asset prices for boomers. Like if you have all these houses and you got to sell them eventually, like I don't know how that shakes out unless the clearing costs and interest rates are lower.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, the other thing that I'm a short term, I think the CapEx boom, I don't know if you guys have read this AI's $600 billion question, but it's pretty good. It just questions the amount of CapEx that's been spent on AI and the amount of revenue that would need to get generated to make that there be a payback. And I think that's a big question mark. So I'm skeptical about if it's just complete up only for AI in the short term. But in the long term, I think you'd be pretty silly to fade it. It's super powerful. And I do think it's really deflationary. So maybe some of these trends in a Goldilocks scenario end up balancing out. But I agree. I think it's really tough to forecast this stuff because it's a period of change. And at the end of the day, no one really knows, right? There's like a lot of factors here.
All I know is that in 20 years, when we do On the Margin, we're going to probably be talking about how labor's power got too extreme and cutting off the profitability of corporates. Like these things are the long-term cycles. We're talking longer term.
And that'll be when Blockworks is the largest independent media conglomerate, because we're never selling out to the MSDNCs of the world.
Yeah.
Yep.
Hell yeah, brothers. We can dream.
We'll be sailing around Mike's yacht in the Med. We'll be recording on summer Fridays.
Is this the meme?
We got a meme of the week here. Yeah. Tyler, did you throw this in?
I think that's about it. It's how effed is our country when an 84-year-old woman is leading a coup to get an 82-year-old president for being too old? It's like, I don't know. I thought that was a really good one.
Gerontocracy, man. I think it's also like, it's a bit of a shame that like we can't even really talk about the other side of policy right now, because they're too busy just like infighting about who the hell is even going to be the nominee. So like, how do we even talk about like the other side? Or like, there's just nothing to talk about. They're literally just infighting about who even is going to be the nominee and whether Biden continues or not. So there's not even like a contra to have right now, which is pretty unfortunate.
I need a caveat. I love boomers. Most boomers are great. But they really let their political system really take an L.
I love boomers. Boomers are the rock of this country.
They're the best.
They created a lot of great things. They're politicians, not the politicians.
My meme of the week was, the shame, if you haven't seen that Kill Tony.
The Kill Tony. I was just thinking about that.
That was some of the hardest I've laughed, where they did the Trump-Biden impressions. That was just phenomenal. So you have to watch. I'm not a like comedian stand-up guy that sits in front of the TV and watches that, but man, that had me going. But my meme of the week is a experience this morning with the Microsoft issues. One of my retirement accounts is at Charles Schwab, and you can't do anything. And obviously, you know, it's just trying to move some things around. And I call the service desk and the lady goes, yeah, sorry, it's impacting us, but it's impacting the whole markets. Markets are down and there's nothing we can do about it. And I was like, meanwhile, trading on like three other platforms and you're watching everything move. You're like, sorry, either you're uninformed or, you know, you're lying. But that was too good. Yeah. It's affecting the whole world. The markets are down. They're closed today. It's like,
Bitcoin ain't down. I'm just looking right now. It just hit a new, it's breaking out onto the next leg higher now, 66,285.
Breaking the bull ledge.
The golden catch-up trade. I've been yelling. That's my new slogan over the last recent weeks. But
keep
like,
saying that, honestly, Felix. I like that. That's good. You gotta claim that.
I mean, honestly, like it was literally the most disconnected I've ever seen macro from crypto. Like everything was shaping up perfectly. And meanwhile, I'm just seeing like the most, like I just started to have to be like incessantly bull posting because it was getting ridiculous.
If you listen to this show, you should be probably, we had the growth slowdown. We had the small caps rotation. We had the screaming top of our lungs that the Germans were being idiots.
I feel like we've been pretty good, but let's not let hubris set in. What you gotta say is keep the chip on your shoulder, baby. I'm from New Jersey. We keep fighting, baby, no matter what, no matter how many wins we get.
We're gonna be so sick of winning by the time this podcast is over.
As soon as you get that, I'm gonna come on there and punch you in the stomach. As soon as you get a little cocky, watch out.
You gotta get humbled. We deserve to get humbled soon, honestly. But we're still gonna gloat a little bit anyway, because
you gotta
live a little too.
This damn the Germans humbled us with the algorithm. The MIT kids with the algorithm. That's the thing.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, I did get made into a Lido community holder through the recent weeks, so that's been a fun experience. But we're coming out through the other side.
Yep.
All right, guys. Thanks for another week.
Good stuff. Later, guys.
See you guys.